Hi friends, this is Manoj Prabhakar from Smart Leaders IAS. In this session of editorial analysis, we are going to have a discussion on editorials that appeared on 11th of February. The first article is on neglected tropical disease. The title of the article is Neglected but Treatable. See, what are neglected tropical disease? They are a diverse group of communicable diseases that prevail in tropical and subtropical conditions. It is prevalent in 149 countries. They affect more than 1 billion people and they cost billions of dollars every year. These neglected tropical disease, they affect more than 1 billion people every year and their social costs running up more than in billions every year. So the WHO, World Health Organization, has identified 17 diseases as neglectable tropical disease. 17 diseases as neglected tropical disease. Of that, 9 are caused because of microparasites and 8 are caused by macroparasites. Who are the worst affected by this neglected tropical disease? The population living in poverty, the population living without adequate sanitation, the population, the people who are living in who are having a good chance of living with infectious vectors. All these three factors can be attributed to developing economies lying in tropical and subtropical region. So the tropical and subtropical region, around 149 countries of tropical and subtropical region, they are affected by this neglected tropical disease. I have added an image there. The image shows the countries, which are the countries dispersing preventive drugs for selection of neglected tropical disease. Based on the geographical location and other factors, climate and other factors, each country experiences a different set of tropical disease. Say for India, a set of around 10 tropical diseases are common in India. So this map shows which are the prominent countries that are being affected by neglected tropical disease. So as we discussed earlier, these are the prevalent neglected tropical diseases of India. The first one is filariasis. Filariasis leads to swelling of lymphatic nodes. This we call as Hathi Pav in Hindi and Yanai Kal in Tamil. And these filaria parasites, it is caused by filaria parasites and it affects lymph nodes. The second disease is soil helminthiasis. Soil helminthiasis is caused by a group of hookworm, roundworm and whipworm. These worms, they cause infections and this is known as soil helminthiasis. The third disease is blinding trachoma. Blinding trachoma is caused by bacterium chlamydia trachomatis. I repeat, it is caused by bacterium chlamydia trachomatis and it causes irritation in eyes, and with that irritation, if it is unnoticed and unreported, untreated, it will lead to blindness. The next is visceral leishmaniasis. It is caused by leishmania parasites which are carried by sandflies. That is, sandflies act as vector for this leishmania parasites. And we all know dengue. Dengue is caused by Aedes aegypti and Aedes albopictus mosquitoes. Dengue is also a neglected tropical disease and which we cannot neglect anymore with this prevalence happening in India recent days. And this is caused by Aedes aegypti and Aedes albopictus mosquitoes. They act as vector for this dengue. The next is rabies. Rabies is caused by rabid dogs and WHO report says that 99% of rabies is caused by domestic dogs, which means we should take more measures to vaccinate the domestic dogs. And the penultimate disease is cysticercosis. This is caused by the tapeworm Taenia solium. I repeat, the cysticercosis disease is caused by tapeworm Taenia solium. And the last is Japanese encephalitis. Japanese encephalitis is caused by a virus called flavivirus, which is transmitted by mosquitoes. Mosquitoes act as vector for this flavivirus. This Japanese encephalitis is one part of different encephalitis found in India. Recently, last year, there was a report that children in Bihar consuming lychee fruit during the time of during summer time, they experienced encephalitis. This is because of hypoglycemia created by lychee fruits. So this table indicates the causes of neglected tropical disease which are prevalent in India. So the image in this screen shows that what are all the benefits that arises out of reducing the burden of NTDs. This is one will be promoting gender equality and empowering women. Second, to improve to reduce child mortality, and third is to combat HIV, malaria and other diseases. The fourth is to improve school attendance. Children are these NTD mostly affect children. When children are affected by disease, their education is getting disturbed. So reducing the burden of NTD is going to improve the school attendance. The fifth is to improve maternal health, and the last is to eradicate extreme poverty and hunger, which is last but not the least. The last goal is to eradicate extreme poverty and hunger. So in India, in order to eradicate this neglected tropical disease, we are following a mass drug administration. This mass drug administration campaign involves the public health workers going door to door distributing tablets to the public. They also provide a kind of communication about the, they also issue communication about the disease and how this tablet is going to help the people in tackling the disease. And this MDA process is done for soy helminthiasis, for which India is organizing National Deworming Day on February 10th. The second is filariasis. Filariasis, the anti-filariasis drugs are given to children about 2 years in districts endemic with filariasis. And the success of MDA program lies with the effectiveness of communication. The large part of the population living under the poverty, who are vulnerable to be affected by NDT, they should be consuming these drugs, but due to lack of awareness, the consumption rate is very low. Also, see, we are giving as a part of mitigation, we are giving people with mass drug administration campaigns and all. Apart from that, there should be some other groundwork, like restricting the vector below threshold, which is crucial for controlling filariasis. Also, the World Health Organization says that wash. There was also a question on 2016 mains on wash. Wash is nothing but water, sanitation, hygiene. This wash strategy can be helpful in handling the neglected tropical disease. How can it treat? First, by prevention. Sanitation reduces the contamination of environment, and safe water supply for consumption, and few of the diseases are transmitted by polluted drinking water. So this wash practice would enable hygiene practices, reducing contact with surface water. Treatment and care. The wash also play a crucial role in treatment and care. How? Water for treatment and care at home. Accessible wash services for individuals with physical impairments. Prevention of stigma-based exclusion from wash, which is very crucial in India, where still few communities are excluded from accessing the public water sources, or violating Article 17 of Indian Constitution. So the wash strategy should also include prevention of stigma-based exclusion from wash. See, these neglectable tropical disease, they have an ability to impact the effectiveness of childhood immunizations. What happens is, if the children are affected by the NTDs, either in their early childhood or during the pregnancy, the parasitic antigens caused by these NTDs is going to create immunomodulations. Because of this, childhood immunization can be made ineffective. Many countries have shown good progress. Around 20 countries have reached a stage by which they don't need any multi-drug administration campaign for filariasis. Our neighboring countries, Sri Lanka and Maldives, they have reached such achievements. India should learn some good practices on such fronts from Sri Lanka and Maldives. The author also says that working on neglected tropical disease leads to universal health coverage. India has proposed to eliminate filariasis by 2020, and how successful the success of India in achieving this target is going to prove our commitment towards neglected tropical disease. The next article is on National Health Protection Scheme or Ayushman Bharat Scheme. The title of the article is Medicare is not healthcare. The author opines that provision of infrastructural facilities should be done first. Only then Medicare facilities like providing insurance to utilize those resources should be provided. So the National Health Protection Scheme was announced in the budget 2018-19. This scheme has the distinction of becoming world's largest government funded health program. And the scheme proposes to cover more than 10 crore poor and vulnerable families, which accounts to around 50 crore Indians, which is 40% of Indian population. The insurance coverage is, the quantum of insurance coverage is rupees 5 lakh rupees per family per year for secondary and tertiary care hospitalization. It's not for primary health care, it's for secondary and tertiary care hospitalization. And this scheme, though it sounds very sweet and paints a rosy picture of future, it has there has been no fund allocated for this scheme, and this has received some criticism from industry majors, policy scholars and public intellectuals. Given a data, what the data signify? We all know there is one particular thing called out-of-pocket expenditure. What is this out-of-pocket expenditure? Out-of-pocket expenditure is the expenditure made by the patients in order to pay for their treatment apart from the insurance coverage. India's out-of-pocket expenditure for healthcare is highest among the world. The world average is 18.2. USA stands at 11% and China stands at 32%, and India, it's almost double the out-of-pocket expenditure of China. It is 63%, which is highest in the world. Few reports also suggest that around 7% of the Indian population is being pushed into poverty. They are impoverished by out-of-pocket expenditure. This National Health Protection Scheme is a welcome move, but it is a kind of revenue expenditure where no physical asset is going to be created. This is just a financial mechanism in order to utilize the existing services or existing facilities. The Rural Health Statistics of 2017 says that only 1,800 hospitals are available in India's rural areas. Out of 700 plus districts in the country, only 1,800 hospitals are available in rural areas. The shortfall with respect to population is 19% of subcenters have shortfall. The subcenters have shortfall of 19%. The public health centers have shortfall of 22%, and community health centers have shortfall of 30%. There is also some other disturbing data. See, there are primary health centers, which are public health centers. The primary health centers, they should have at least one doctor, and a few data suggests that even highly developed states like Kerala and Tamil Nadu have a number of primary health centers without even a single doctor. What are the numbers? Kerala, they have 5.9% of PHCs without doctors. In Tamil Nadu, it is 7.6%. West Bengal and Jharkhand, few of the highly populated states in the country, they have 41% of PHCs without doctors, and in Bihar, it is too pathetic. In Bihar, more than 63.6% of primary health centers are without even a single doctor. These health centers, they lack proper physical infrastructure. They lack proper buildings. Apart from physical infrastructure, they also lack human infrastructure. That is, they lack requisite staff and other basic facilities. Niti Aayog has released a state-wise healthcare index, and these data are taken from Niti Aayog state-wise healthcare index. Of this, they have taken a survey of specialty doctors. The specialty doctors of this more than 16.7% of Tamil Nadu has the lowest vacancy in specialty doctors, which is 16.7%, and Chhattisgarh has highest vacancy in specialty doctors, which stands at pathetic value of 77%. So PhDs without doctors is also high. To make things even worse, many PhDs in Rajasthan, Bihar, they lack even a staff nurse. See, insurance is obviously going to incentivize the private players so that they will expand more in rural areas, providing health services to rural public. But we have also seen the cases of increasing number of hysterectomy done in Andhra Pradesh after the introduction of Arogya Shri scheme. Arogya Shri is the health insurance scheme that is a Medicare provided by the Andhra Pradesh government to the people of Andhra. There were some allegations of increasing hysterectomy done by private hospitals. Apart from this, this is going to inflate the cost of medical services. Also, this will hurt the out-of-pocket. This will also count in out-of-pocket expenditure. Since the cost of medical services is going to increase, it will also have an impact on out-of-pocket expenditure. Providing world's largest Medicare is going to take much money from investing more on that. There are also some projection says that it takes more than 2.6% of our GDP. Since much money, somewhere around 2.6% of our GDP spent on Medicare, development of physical infrastructure in healthcare in health centers are going to lack finance. This is going to pose a real challenge in developing physical infrastructure and running it efficiently. Almost 25% of PhDs in India, they lack 24/7 power supply. This shows the pathetic situation. Based on all these factors, the author has opined that in the provided scenario, healthcare has to be given more preference than the Medicare. Considering all these scenarios, the author has come to the conclusion that at this present given situation, healthcare which involves improving the physical infrastructure of the hospitals to be given more preference than Medicare. Thank you.